Good morning, Journey family. Such a beautiful day outside, right? Yeah, it's a blessing to be here, right? Amen. So again, welcome to Journey. My name is Leonard Small. Welcome all of our first-time guests, visitors, friends, everybody. Just a blessing to see a lot of faces this morning. Feels good, right? All right. If you're a first-time guest, you have any changes to your address, prayer request, you're receiving our offering here in a little bit. So if you can go ahead and fill this out, drop this in the offering plate as it goes around. We're going to be praying for that. Today we're going to pray for a new church plant. It's a friend of mine named Mark Dickerson. He's at Journey Church, Amazing Life Campus. It's off of it's in the Arlington towards the beaches area. So I'm going to pray as they gather. This is like the third or fourth Sunday, so we're going to pray for them. I'll go ahead and bring the offering and go ahead and receive that. Let's go ahead and pray for it. Just thank you for their for your church, Lord God. We have been just blessed with this opportunity to be the light of the world. As Jesus has come, He's given us the blueprint. We're supposed to act and live life. And Lord God, we just thank you for sending us the Holy Spirit, one body, under your blood, under the Holy Spirit, that we can make a difference here in Jackson. We pray for Journey Church, Amazing Life Campus, under the pastoring of Mark Dickerson. We just pray that as they gather today, Lord God, you in the midst of their church service, we pray that you will give him wisdom on how he will pastor that church, Lord God, all the resources and people that he needs to share your gospel to the lost. Lord God, we pray that you send that to them. And as we're here, Lord God, preparing to receive, we just pray that you will give us the wisdom and the knowledge to put it in the right places in a way and use it in a way that will glorify you. And we just thank you in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Inside of your church bulletin, this little green piece of paper right here is a lot of information. So let's go through a couple things. The New Ladies Bible Study has already started, but you can still get into it. Sunday evening, 6:30. Information is right there. Also, we have some families that are in need of meals. Details is in the church bulletin. They're dealing with different ill, sick children. So if you can bless them, that'd be awesome. Next, we will talk about Operation Christmas Child. Next weekend is the last weekend to turn in your gift boxes. So, on the table under the TV in the cafe, if you want more information, you can pick up a box, you can turn it in. We need to have them in next Sunday. We'll also have the Guatemala School Sponsorship Programs. Hey, there will be a table set up at this door exiting out. Big deal. Unlike America, you know, we're blessed that our children can go and our tax dollars education. Not so in some other countries like Guatemala. Education costs. So if you find it in your heart, starting this weekend, and there will be a table out there. They'll continue. You can get a child and sponsor that child as they try to make it through school. And that's it. God bless.
All right. Good morning. Just a word about the sponsorship for the Guatemalan children. You see in there some different amounts for sponsoring those kids. That's just time sponsorship. So $30, $50 will help a child go to school for a year, provide a uniform and all that stuff. So great way to be a blessing to some children. And we'll have some more information about that in the coming weeks, but we are blessed to be a blessing. Amen? I notice there's a number of visitors. I want to welcome you to Journey Church. If you're visiting, my name's Vic. Good to have you with us. We often talk about the church and try to help people understand that, you know, the church that meets within four walls. It's not a building. It's not an organization. We say at Journey Church there are how many churches in Jacksonville and in the world? Okay, and what is church? Anybody remember that? The family of God living on mission. So it is a family. It's not an organization. It's a family. It's people who are adopted into God's family. It's God living together on mission, the mission that God has given us to share His love with the world around us. So being a family, it's important for us to, you know, make sure that this is not come to and see and experience on Sunday morning, but it's a body that you get connected to, and that takes effort on your part. We do everything we can to help that make that happen. Opportunities, whether it's fellowship events. One of the things in the bulletin is Journey Christmas Party, adult Christmas party, which is just always a ton of fun. Everybody is invited, and you bring a gag gift and try to keep it semi-tasteful. But it's an opportunity to connect with people, get to know people, so I can manage those, so you can become more a part of the family. We have a part of the family this morning that we are rejoicing with, and where are the Paulas? I want to invite you guys to come up. I want to invite the Paulas to come up. They recently welcomed their first child into this world. And so, come on. This is, well, come on up, you all right? This is Drowsia, Daniel, and you all right? Come on up, Maria, and little baby Lucas. Little man, as we refer to him. Oh, little big man. But this morning, as a family, we want to come together and dedicate this child to the Lord. As we go through Scripture, churches practice infant baptism. That's not something that we find in the Bible, so we don't practice that. Baptism is always something that happens as an adult, someone who puts their faith in Jesus and understands that. But we do see in the Bible, Hannah, who dedicated Samuel to the Lord and just thank God for this gift of child, and say, God, we want to give this child back to you, and he's yours, and we want you to bless him and help us to raise him. And so as a family, we want to come together and surrender God's love and pray for them and pray for this little man. And so I would ask you to join me as we dedicate this child to the Lord. God, thank you so much for this family. Thank you for the Paulas. Thank you for blessing them in so many ways. And God, the gift of this child is just an incredible blessing. We thank you for that. And God, we pray for little Lucas and lift him up to you, and we acknowledge that he is a gift from you. God, you created him with a purpose. There's purpose in his life. God, it's our prayer and our desire to enter into those purposes at a young age. God, help Daniel and Drowsia to raise him in a way that would encourage him to follow you. God, we pray by your Spirit. Just lay his steps out before him. Fill him with your Spirit at a young age, God. And we just commit him to you and this family. God, and as a family of believers, we come around them and we thank them. And God, we just say that we'll do our part, however we can, to encourage them and to help them along the way. God, may we love one another in such a way that it encourages not just us as a family, but our children to follow you. And we thank you for that. And God, help them to steward this gift well. And may he be a blessing to this world, just as you intended. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You got any picture takers out here? All right, go ahead. I'll get out of the way. There you go. Thank you. Awesome. Gosh, maybe we never get to the point that we forget that church is really about relationship and about family. If we do, then I think we're all in trouble. I was away with my family last weekend, and Leonard shared a great job. We're continuing on in a series. For those of you who are visiting, we're going through a series on the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5 through Matthew 7. It's called Life Redefined. He stepped to this earth, he redefined life because he was the first person who didn't just die and be put in the ground. He rose from the dead, and in that, he redefined life. Teaching redefines life for us. I'm going to give you a little backdrop to the passage that we're going to go through today. Jesus is up on the side of a mountain, and he starts teaching his disciples. Gathering, all different kinds of people are gathering, and so it's disciples, it's followers, it's curious people, it's religious leaders, Jews, Gentiles, people from all walks of life. Whether it's teaching them, he's teaching them about what it means to have an intimate relationship with God, not just some religious interaction, but really what it means to have a relationship with God. He taught them how to pray, and when he taught them how to pray, he gave them a formula you do to get God to do what you want him to, like you pray this and then God will do this, or you have to use special words. In fact, he says, don't go babbling like, you know, some religion. Just talk to God simply. And he lays out, you know, this is how you pray. And then he reminds them of the need to give to the needy. That's the heart of God. We went through that a few weeks ago, that God for the poor, the downtrodden, the marginalized, and he always looked out for them. And he said, when you give to the needy, do that secretly. Don't put a big show on like some people did. And the religious leaders of that time, they made their religion. And so Jesus is teaching them, and he says, you know, this is really about a relationship with your Father. Okay, and then Leonard taught this past week on the passage that said, don't store up your treasures here on earth and rust destroy, but store them up in heaven. You know, everything here is temporary. We need to remember that, right? You can't take it with you. The one with the most toys still dies, okay? You know, it's like the one with the most toys wins. No, you still die. Matthew 6:21, where your treasure is, there your heart will. So how you invest your time, your resources, your finances, that really shows where your heart's at. A lot of people, you can talk a good talk. You know, people who talk a good talk, salesmen, saleswomen, they can talk, but what are you doing with your time? What are you doing with your money? What are you doing with the resources that you've been given? That'll show really where your heart's at. You can't serve two. You can't serve both God and money. Jesus made that real, real clear. And if you get bound and you find yourself bound by worry and anxiety, worry. That's a tough one for a lot of us, but when we find ourselves bound by worry and anxiety, it's usually because we're looking to something else to fulfill us. Something else has become that important in our life, and everything outside of God is fleeting, and you really ultimately cannot trust in that long term. Because you can't serve two Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Seek first His kingdom. So you got to ask yourself this question, how much does my stuff mean to me? Jesus doesn't say it's bad to have stuff. He doesn't say it's bad to have good stuff or good things. He goes, just make sure those things don't have you. And Leonard did a great job talking about that last year. You can go on our website and listen to that message. So this is the backdrop to the passage that we're going to look at today. And the passage we're looking at today is one that's often quoted, often missed, particularly the first verse. So I'm going to read through Matthew 7, 1 to 5 as we get started. This is Jesus speaking. Do not judge, or you too will be judged. Anybody heard that? Anybody throw that in your face? Yeah? For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there's a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. All right, let's pray. God, help us to understand what you're saying to us. Holy Spirit, speak to our hearts. God, help me to communicate really just what you want to say. And may it be for our benefit to grow in you, but also for the benefit of the people around us, that we might do what you've called us to do, do what you created us to do, and do it more effective. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so when we look at the scripture, remember, context is always most important. And so when Jesus says this, what's the context, okay? He just got done talking about the Pharisees, the religious leaders, who made a big show out of their religion, out of their prayer. They made a big show out of how they gave to the needy, announce it, and it was all, you know, drawing attention to them. All right, and he says they're hypocrites, they're play actors. I mean, they look like they're very religious, but their hearts are far from me. You know, so don't be like that. Okay, so that's the backdrop. That's kind of the context here. Now he begins to talk about passing judgment on people and being careful that you don't condemn, which is something the Pharisees were known for at the time. Okay, look at verses 1 and 2 again. Do not judge, or you too will be judged. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Now this sounds like a warning, right? When you read it, it's like, be careful how you pass judgment, who you judge. Because the same measure that you use is going to be used on you. You've heard it said, don't judge a book by its cover, right? And if we're all going to be honest, we do. We'd say, no, I really try not to. Listen, we make judgments on people just when they walk by, often. And we have to be very careful, because you cannot know a person's heart by their outward appearance. You know, sometimes we think we can, but you can't always. I remember one of the most difficult meetings I was ever in as a church leader. We were doing an outreach to a lot of kids on the street, teenagers, things like that. And we were drawing a lot of kids who, from the kind of the fringe of society, you know, the colored hair, piercings, all these things, coming into the church. We would hold concerts and reach out to these kids, and sometimes we'd invite guys and girls who were Christians, and they often looked like these kids that were coming in. And I remember some people really struggled with that, you know, and our approach was, you know, Paul said, I become all men so that I might win some. Not that I take on their lifestyle, but culturally, you know, we can be relevant and not compromise the gospel. And so I just remember one guy just, we can't have people like that in our church. And I'm just going, really? I'm sitting there, and you know, there's a group of leaders, and then one of the next comments was, you can't tell me that a guy gets up on stage like that with tattoos and all, you can't tell me that the Holy Spirit lives inside someone like that. Like, I'm not going to tell you that, but read your Bible, you know? I mean, the Holy Spirit lives inside all different kinds of people, right? And although we would like everyone to kind of be like us, and, you know, it's just not the case. All to be like us is becoming a Christian doesn't mean you become this cookie cutter kind of person. Jesus and his apostles, they still had a personality. Man, it's one of the or at least I love about Peter. You know, the guy still would put his foot in his mouth. He still would just, he'd be out there. I mean, they were going to arrest Jesus. He takes a sword out, cuts the guy's ear off. I mean, that's awesome. Even though Jesus was like, no, we don't, he's like, we don't work that way. We don't do that anymore. And he patches up the dude. And, but listen, come on, guys. We're all us here. Don't be careful how you judge. And be careful to these snap judgments. Have you ever tried to help somebody and you just really, you love them, you care about them, you go, hey, don't judge me. Who are you? God's my judge. Right? You know, you need to look at yourself. And even though there's an element of truth there, we have to understand, Jesus is not saying, don't make any judgments. He's not saying, do not be discerning. He's not saying, don't judge situations or even sin. Not saying that. If he was saying that, he would be contradicting other scripture. He told us you judge a tree by its fruit. Okay? So you can know a bit about it by the action that you see. And that's okay. The problem that we run into is when we start condemning those people and think that we're up here and they're down here. Then we're in. Because it's only by grace that any of us can stand. But I want to make sure we understand, there is room for judgment, and we do need to judge and be discerning. 2:13-15, this is Paul who writes, this is what we speak, not in words taught us by human wisdom, but in words taught by the Spirit, expressing spiritual truths and spiritual words. The man without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, and he cannot understand them, because they are spiritually discerned. The spiritual man makes judgments about all things, but not subject to any man's judgment. So according to Paul, people, men and women who have the Spirit, do make judgments about things. There's discernment. There's another occasion where Jesus rebukes the Pharisees, and it's about their judgment of him in John 7:21-24. And Jesus said, I did one miracle, and you are all astonished, yet because Moses gave you circumcision, actually, it did not come from Moses, but from the patriarchs, you circumcise a child on the Sabbath. Now, if a child can be circumcised on the Sabbath so that the law of Moses may not be broken, why are you angry with me killing the whole man on the Sabbath? Stop judging by mere appearances and make right judgment. Okay? So, don't just judge by outward appearance. Make proper judgment. So, he's saying there is room, there's a need to judge. There's other passages through Scripture that talk about when there's sin in the church, how you deal with that. Or if you have a brother or a sister who sins against you, you deal with that. So there is need to be discerning and to judge. But there's not room for this condemnation. And that's what the Pharisees were doing. They were experts at the law, but they missed the heart of the law. And they thought they were here, and everyone else was down here. And they would condemn people for whatever. They didn't follow the way. And so be very careful that you don't condemn people because they're not like you. Or because they're in a very, very sinful state where they're far from God, practicing a lifestyle that's far from God. And you acknowledge that and understand that, but you don't stand there like you're better than them. Because you're not. And I'm not. Can you get yourself to the place where you realize that you're not any better than anyone else? And if you think of the worst of the worst. Because it's only because of what Jesus has done that any of us can stand before God. So he's talking about hypocritical judgment. He's talking about people who forget who they are and the fact that it's by grace that they are saved. Matthew 7:3-5. Look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own. How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there's a plank in your own? You hypocrite, take the plank out of your own eye, then you'll see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. So he's reminding the Pharisees and all of us that, you know, we have no right to judge someone in a way that puts ourselves above anyone else. Okay, I'm going to remind you of a passage that the last four times that I've been up here teaching, or actually probably five times I've brought this up. Romans 3, 12, or, but now a righteousness from God apart from the law has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified freely by His grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. There is no difference in every one of us. And all, by faith, are justified freely. Okay? So let's get this out of our mind, out of our head, out of our hearts, that somehow we're better than the homeless person sleeping on the street. Or the homosexual person who, you know, you've spent time just judging and condemning. Aside from the blood of Jesus, aside from the grace of God, none of us are any better. Just because we know God, we've experienced that grace. And so it's not wrong to recognize the sin and to call it sin. Okay, we can't be afraid of that. But it's wrong when we start doing that. Does that make sense? Okay. Now, Jesus, when he says this, you know, there's a big crowd there. The religious leaders are there. And he's pointing out the fact that this is what they do. Okay, they were experts at this. And if you ever thought that Jesus didn't have a sense of humor, just read some of these passages. I mean, read it for yourself. He's like, do you realize how ridiculous this is? Okay? You want to take the speck out of someone's eye. And he goes, all right, so you're I can't get through this with my glasses on. So you're walking around. It's like, what you do would be like this. Like, I come out, hey, Joe. Good, good. You know, we've been hanging out for a while, and Joe comes over to my house. We watch football and stuff together, and Joe, we've been hanging, and you know, as we've been hanging out, I got to know you. I don't know if you realize it or not, but there's a little something in your eye. You got a little issue, and I wanted to see if I could help you with this you got going on with your eyes. Okay. Now, how ridiculous is that, right? He's like, you're walking around trying to get a little speck out of something with a plank hanging out of yours. Don't you see that? Don't you realize that? Don't forget. You got issues. Okay? You got issues. We all have issues. So before, now this is an interesting thing, because Jesus goes, all right, don't judge. But really what he's saying is don't judge hypocritically. Trying to help your brother or sister, man, deal with your issues. Okay, you got a big issue hanging here out of your eye. All right? So, work on yourself. Take a good look in the mirror. All it takes is a little glance, right? A little glance in the mirror, you go, man, I got something going on here. Can someone help a brother out? Right? So, take a look in the mirror of God's Word. Do a little inspection. Okay, how am I doing here? And as you grow in your relationship with God, then he goes, then you'll be able to help out your brother or your sister. Do that. Hey, don't you know, you don't judge me. God's my judge. Listen, we're here for each other. And it really depends on your heart when you're talking about this. Okay? How you go about helping someone out. So if I got something, anyone ever have... Most of us have something in your eye, right? Have you ever had one of those things where you just, man, something's in your eye, you can blinking and it's scratching and you're going and you can't get it out. You use one of those lady mirrors that magnifies everything like this, and you're trying to get it out. You know, you've been there. Have you ever helped someone get something out of their eye? As soon as you, like, to me, as soon as you open up the eyelid like that and the eyeball is like, it's like you've entered a at that point, like, the eyeball is a weird, I mean, to me, it's just weird looking, you know? So you're trying it, but you got to get it out, right? So how do you do it? What do you do? If you have something in your eye, are you going to call the doctor or the auto mechanic? You're calling the doctor, right? Because he knows what he's doing. He's a little more gentle, right? But as Christians who want to be a blessing and want to help people, we come in, hey, you got something in your eye. I got an ice pick and a hammer, and I'm going to help you get that thing out of your eye. grips, right? And I'm going to help you deal with your issues. And rather than come in with the gentleness of a surgeon, which I would say that's how God treats us and how Jesus treats us, we come in like, man, you need to repent. Don't you realize? I mean, you're offending God right now. You know, like we're up here and you better get it right. I don't even know if you're a believer. You say you're a believer. I don't even know if you're a believer the way you're acting. Don't forget where you came from. Don't forget you still have issues. Maybe your issue's not quite like this anymore. You know, maybe you just got a little stick in there. Or maybe well, and you're following Jesus but man, none of us are perfect. We all still have issues. And so sometimes when we go and we want to help a brother or sister out, more harm than good. And so we have to be careful. But I want to say, in no way, shape, or form is Jesus saying, ignore sin. Is he saying, don't deal with sin, or don't call something sin. But you can do that in a loving way where you really want to help the other person. If a person is God, our hearts should break for that person because they're bound. Listen, if you ever had something in your eye and you couldn't get it out, most of us want that out, right? You're like, man, that's driving me crazy. Do everything you can to get that out. When people are bound by that kind of stuff, they might not show it, but most of those people want to be free. Now, they might not be at that place where they're ready to receive. Most people want to be free. And so we got to decide if we're going to help them or are we going to push them further away. But not everybody wants help. He loves us. And he wants us to grow in our relationship with him so that we can help other people. But it is true, not everyone wants help. Look at where Jesus goes right after that, okay? Matthew 6. Do not give dogs what is sacred. Do not throw your pearls to pigs. If you do, they may trample them under their feet and then turn and tear you to pieces. That's a tough one. I mean, now when you first read that, if you pull that one out of context, you go, man, you can use that to get up on your high horse real high. You know, I'm not throwing swine. You know, they don't want, you know, I try to share Jesus with them and they don't. It's real easy to get yourself up here and go, I'm just not going to give them my time because they're not worthy of it. Well, based on everything Jesus has said to this point, I don't think that's the case. But there is a reality that some people, right now, they don't want your help. And there is a point at which sometimes you just need to say, okay, I'm moving on. See, sometimes when we try to help, and we keep trying to help, and they keep abusing you, all we do is enable them. And then we're not helping them. And it's really not, okay, at times, what God wants us to do. God doesn't want you to continually get hurt or abused. Let me say that first, you know, foremost, okay, up front. So he doesn't say you have to continue to put yourself to abuse to try to help somebody. There's a point at which we walk away, not to walk away and say, man, you're God forsaken, I don't want anything to do with you. We walk away believing that God will deal with their hearts, that the Spirit will work on them, and trusting them into God's hands because there's really nothing I can do at this point anymore. And when Jesus says this, you know, listen, don't listen to swine. Don't. When he says this, remember again the context and remember the crowd. I think he's certainly alluding to the situation that is ongoing between him and the religious leader. Okay, because he goes, listen, if you throw your pearls to swine, eventually they're going to come and they're going to tear you to pieces. These guys were already plotting, how are we going to kill that guy? And so he still teaches, and they're there, but you never see Jesus. You never see Jesus going and going after any of the Pharisees as far as pursuing them. But this is key. When they come to him, he's always there with love, wanting to minister to them just like he would anyone else. Okay? Now these are guys who want to kill him. These are the guys who pass judgment on him all the time. If this guy was really a prophet, He would know what that woman's life is like who's washing his feet. Why does he go to the house of sinners? Why does he... Okay? They're passing judgment on him all the time. But then this guy named Nicodemus shows up. And he's one of the religious leaders. And he asks Jesus some questions. And Jesus sits with him and he welcomes him. And if you read at the end of the story of the gospel, he ends up becoming one who follows Jesus. So, what does that mean to us? There is a point, I think, at times where you give and you give and you give, and a person just doesn't want it, don't want to hear it. There's a point where you recognize that you're enabling or that you're being harmed in the process, and you say, all right, God, I have to give this person to you. It's for my own good and for the good work in their hearts. Okay? And you may need to walk away for a season. But when God does that work, we got to be prepared to continue to love and show grace that he's shown to us. Okay? Does that make sense? It's hard. Especially when you talk about family, people you love. It's hard at times to draw a line in the sand and go, you know what? There needs to be some tough love here. So what do you do in those moments? Well, Jesus, I think, helps us out here. And in his little part of this message is about prayer. Look at verses 7 to 12. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be open to you. For everyone who asks, receives. He who seeks, finds. And to him who knocks, the door will be opened. Which of you, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? And though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children. How much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? So in everything, do to others would have them do to you, for this sums up the law and the prophets. I love these verses, okay? Ask and it will be given. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be open. As you're trying to help other people, as you're trying, you're looking in the mirror and you're trying to get whatever's in your own eye, whatever's in your own heart out, and you're trying to help God. You know, seek him, ask him, ask him for his help. He is your loving Father that is waiting there to help you. Make sure you get that picture of God and not that picture of God in your mind and in your heart. Because we all have issues. He goes, listen, if you, although you are evil, give good gifts to your children, how much more would your Father, who's perfect, give you good gifts? He loves you. But don't forget, before you go judging someone, remember, we all have our issues. We all have sin that we need to deal with. Go to God. Ask him to work on your heart. Ask him to work on those issues. Just so you can be blessed, but so you can be a blessing to the world. Because as you do that work, then God works in your heart. And you know how to reach out to other people and how to help other people. Not to be the one who comes, you know, with the ice pick and vice grips to take something out of someone's eye. But as God works, that loving surgeon works on you, cutting things out, and he does that work, well, then we understand how to help other people and how to do that. Levi, I'm going to ask you guys to come back up. I think it's interesting, at the end of this verse, Jesus is judging. He's talking about getting stuff out of your life that needs to get out. He's talking about helping others. He's talking about throwing pearls to the rain, all right? All of this, and then he sums it up with, but in all things, do to other people as you would have them do to you. I mean, that's pretty cool. With a tough issue here. Okay? He's talking about sin. He's talking about getting out of our lives. He's talking about helping brothers and sisters who might be deep in sin. He's talking about having to walk with people at times. And he goes, but whatever. Make sure this is what undergirds it all. Do to others as you would have them do to you. If you found yourself in that situation, I want people to treat you. That's how you should treat others. That's how you should treat the people who are far from God. And he goes, seek God. Ask. Whatever your needs are, come to the Father. He loves you. He's a perfect, perfect loving Father. How do you see your relationship with God? Is He that loving Father who invites you in, who knows all your issues but still loves you and says, I want to help you with those? Or is He the Father who is standing there with condemning eyes and makes you just feel unworthy? Because that's not the God of the Bible. That's not the God who sent Jesus to die for your sins. And so this morning I want to make sure that we have a picture, a true picture of that loving Father, the one who's the gentle and who will help you get that stuff out of your life that needs to come out, who will help you be a blessing to others in the midst of it. And so what we're going to do is we're going to take a few here and we're going to pray, sing a couple songs, and I just want to invite you to take a little bit of time before God. Maybe do some introspection. Maybe inside. And so, I guess at first, if you would just remain seated, we'll walk us through a little time of prayer. We're going to sing a song, and I just ask that you let that be your prayer. Hear the voice of God. Okay? If you would, as for a moment, let's just go before the Father. God, I pray that You would help us to see You for who You are. God, so many of us have so many different stories of fathers in our lives, parents who were a lot less than and gave us a lot less of the love that maybe they should have. And it's affected how we view You as our God. God, by Your Spirit, help us to see You as You are. That loving Father who, just as You remind in this passage, God, that if we were to be give gifts to our children and they ask us for something, we're not going to trick them. And when they ask for a piece of bread and give them a stone, if they want a toy, we're not going to give them something that harms. And God, Your Word says You're just like that, but You're perfect. And as we love to give good gifts to children, we love to see them smile, full of joy, running to play. God, that's how You view us. Help us to see that this morning. Help us to believe that there's purpose in our reason for us to look into the mirror of Your Word and to clean up our hearts and our minds and our lives, because not because You want us to measure up to something that You have for us to do. There's a love that this world needs to experience, and I believe every person in this room is alive because You want to use us to be a part of extending that love to people. But first, we've got to look at our own hearts. First, we need to know who we are in You. God, help us to hear Your voice, that loving Father. Mom, come as You are. Lay it all on the table. Confess. I've already sent My Son to die for you. His blood's already been shed. Forgive. So just hear the voice of God in this song. If you want to sing it, you can, but really just listen. Listen to what God would say to you.
From wherever You've been, come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find Your mercy, O sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can heal.
Think about the pain, struggle, I know in my own life over the years, and just all of us in this room, sometimes we just wonder, why, God? Why do we go through this? Your word says, Lord, that as we walk through, we learn to persevere, and as we learn to persevere, then as we seek healing and find healing, then it gives us the opportunity to others who walk through similar things. So God, I pray that we'd find that healing this morning. That we would be a blessing to this world. God, that you take the brokenness of all of our lives and something beautiful. Something that you can use, God, and you use us in the midst of our brokenness, and I thank you for that. I'm going to ask you if you would, if you'd stand with me. We're going to finish with a song, and as always, we have communion on either side of the room. If you feel led to just break bread and take the cup, God's done for you. If you just want to take some time, but let's sing this song together. And remember our brokenness, the brokenness of the world all around us, and that He takes people in this room, and He takes that brokenness and makes it into something beautiful, and it's a blessing to the world. And He wants to use every single one of us. Let's sing this together.
All this pain, I wonder if I'll ever find my way. I wonder if could really change at all. All this earth, could all that is lost ever be found? Could a God have come up from this ground at all? life is springing up from the soul ground. Out of chaos, life is being found.
And make something beautiful. You can take a broken and make it into something beautiful. God, we thank you. We praise you for that. Remind us of that for ourselves and then for people around us who are broken, hurting, taking pain on themselves. God, you have the ability to make something beautiful out of that. Help us to never forget that. Help us to be people who persevere, who want to help. Come to you and pray and ask and seek and knock and believe. God, you resurrect lives. You resurrect marriages. God, you can make something beautiful out of the worst of circumstances. Remind us of that. Help us to see ourselves as beautiful in your eyes. It's so hard, God. Look in the mirror and feel so unworthy at times. But praise you, God, because Jesus has come. And as a result of that, you are worthy. Worthy to be a part of your plan. Worthy to be a part of your family. Worthy to be used by you in this world to bring that beauty in the midst of brokenness. God, this place. Maybe go with our heads held high, knowing that we're loved by you, blessed by you, but blessed that we might be a blessing. And may the world be a better as a result. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If anyone needs prayer for anything, some of us up here would love to pray with you going on in life. God bless you. Peace be with you. We'll see you next week.
I'm like the Raptors, I got weak first draft. So when I'm dropping a new flow, all that solid at first post, you might call it a roof show. But ballers improve, yo. And in the same way, soon as tunes get better, and I polish a judo. Who knows? I might get acknowledged. Cool though, long as I keep rocking a few shows. Not some models, some new clothes. Pocket that loot, bro. I'm